I want to say I didn't start out to write so many memoirs. When I was in the States, you know, the book tour, there was a very posh chauffeur comes to pick me up from some hotel in Seattle, and he drives celebrities around. So he sees me, he knows I'm not a celebrity. He says, "Oh, you must be a writer." I said, "Yeah, I'm a writer." He says, "What do you write?" I said, "Oh, mostly memoirs." He looks at me, he says, "You don't look so old. To have, how many memoirs have you written?" I said, "Oh, four." He goes, "My God, you must have a very interesting life." I said, "No, I'm very self-involved. It's that's all that happened." But it never started out that way. It was really my mother's fault. She, even when she was very young, 20, you know, she was living in Kenya and very glamorous, and she already understood that she should be worthy of a biography in the vein of Isaac Dinesen or Beryl Markham. But she was too lazy to write a book herself. So when she was pregnant with my older sister, she read my sister the entire works of Shakespeare in the womb, just in the hope that when my sister was born, she would just want to write a biography of my mother one day. But the result was my sister is willfully illiterate. She refuses to read or write. She won't read my books. She, you know. You know how if you fly to the United States, they give you that green card. Have you now, or have you ever been a terrorist? Or, you know, you're a drug addict. You have a communicable disease. My sister came over with my mother to visit me. She wouldn't bother to read it. She just said, "Yes, yes, 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 yes." So she's arrested at Newark. My mother said, "Oh, it was fantastic, serves her right." So by the time I was 5 years old, and it was I grew up in the Rhodesian War, and my parents liked the view of the farm. They didn't pay attention to anything else. So the view of these beautiful Mozambique Hills was also the minefield that separated what was then, you know, Rhodesia from Mozambique. So it was very beautiful and very dangerous. And it was too dangerous to go to school. The roads had landmines and there were ambushes. So what the Rhodesian government did was they sent school, correspondence school to the parents to teach the parents, the children, you know. My mother would pull this packet out. She'd throw away the mathematics. She'd, "No, darling, you always pay someone to count for you. But now who are you going to write about?" So by the time, you know, I'd had this, actually a very privileged education because I was white, and just out of that sheer unearned merit and privilege of being white, I was given really a fantastic education, except in French. But really, that was the thing that stayed with me more than anything, that when the war ended, I realized sometimes, or often, you know, you have privilege. It was nothing of, you did nothing for the privilege, just the mere fact of being born was enough to give me this privilege. And it changed everything. And the way that I write, the way that I think, the way that I come at everything, I think I have a duty to be very honest and explore where that privilege came from and how unearned it was and how much violence and alcohol it took for a whole country to grip onto so much privilege. And it's an interesting parallel in the United States. It makes people very uncomfortable, but, you know, I say in the United States, they assume a sort of global privilege, but who gave that to you? You didn't earn it, you know, and when you put yourself in a position of superiority and oppression, there will be consequences, there will be a reaction to that. So much of my thinking, too, is really about identity and about, you know, how you arrive at your position. Anyway, I grew up, I couldn't count, I could only write, and I had made a vow very young I would never leave, you know, Zimbabwe and Zambia was, for me, that was, it was home. And I was the first generation. My great-grandfather went to Kenya. My mother and father were in Kenya, but they still said that England was home. And I was the first generation to say, no, this is home. Clearly, I mean, we had been through a war for it. There'd been so much to attach, so much violence, so much blood, so much difficulty to attach me to that soil. And I deeply, deeply, deeply loved it. So there was a really terrible shock when I was 18. And my parents, I don't know why it didn't occur to them earlier to tell me this, that you're not African. You're English. Your passport's English. I mean, I was horrified. I thought, I'm not English. I mean, look at me. I'm loud and I'm wild. And the English haven't had an official emotion since 1776. This is going to be a disaster. And to go over there, England felt to me, I didn't understand the English. I knew, you know, my parents had raised me with certain English rules. I just was so confused when I went there. You know, the way the English are with their manners, and it was like I understood the vocabulary of being English, but I didn't understand the grammar, you know? And I didn't belong there, I knew that. And yet, that was the birthright I'd been given. And it's funny, it's ironic, because so many people, of course, are dying to leave Zimbabwe. They would do anything for a British passport. But if somebody had given me a choice, you know, what passport do you select? It wouldn't have been an English passport. And I had also understood very early on that in the culture of my family, my parents had this very passionate love affair. And we were really just, my sister and I, a sort of byproduct of this great passion. But it was a love triangle. It was, my mother loved the land and my father adored my mother. And so they had in common this sort of grand passion that was really rooted in the African soil and then for each other. And I was too young to understand that I had inherited my mother's grand passion, that my first love, my deepest love, truly was for land. You know, if some man came along, well, that was nice, but it wasn't the most important thing. And anyway, men couldn't get anywhere near my sister and me, because we lived so far from anywhere by then. We were almost on the Congo border. And so just to drive to get to the farm, it was 4 or 5 hours. I mean, it's a big journey to have a cup of tea with someone and see if... And then the horror, they get to the farm and there's my father, he's always got a gun. And then they would arrive on the farm having traveled for days and days and days. And they would fall in love with my mother instead of my sister and me. I thought, this is it, I'll be a spinster forever, I'll never get married. But when I met my American husband, I thought, well, he was a river guide in Zambia and he had come out from the States. And it seemed to me that he had the same grand passion for rivers, which I didn't really understand, but it felt like an equivalent love that I had for land. I thought, oh, well then, this can be the same as, you know, me and my parents, that there's this bigger thing that you love, because I think it's very difficult to sustain a passionate love with another human being if that's just the two of you. I mean, I think that's... Even then, I knew this is impossible. He's just a man, you know, he's not God or anything. So, and he promised me, no, we'll remain in Zambia. And my daughter, who's staying with me here, she was born in Zimbabwe. And then he became terrified, you know, the politics, the malaria and so on. So he took me back to the States. And so, of course, you don't realize that this at the time, but I was in the process of being dispossessed and repossessed and dispossessed. And so my first dispossession was of the land, to have moved to the States and to feel completely foreign. You know, I look, if you did, before I open my mouth, I look like a normal American housewife, you know? But my thinking, my soul, everything about me, I was African. So really, I was in mourning for when I got to the States, and the culture shocked me. The thing that struck me to begin with was how possessive the Americans are of time. And it was the first time I'd ever heard this. Don't waste my time. And when I heard that, I laughed. Because who gave you time? How can time belong to you? Time's just time. It's not your thing. And how angry they got if you were too long at the traffic lights or in paying your, you know, whatever. And so it really was a sort of learning. I had to relearn this other culture. But the one thing I was very excited about was growing up in Rhodesia. Censorship started in Rhodesia in 1964 at the Unilateral Declaration of Independence. And what the Rhodesian government did was they censored the newspapers completely. But what the editors of the newspapers did was brilliant. Instead of just removing, you know, the words that the Rhodesians said could not be printed, they left instead white space. So when you picked up the newspaper, you could see, you couldn't see what had been taken out, but you could see that something had been taken out. And that again was a fabulous lesson for me, that what is being unsaid is most important. And I think that also is everything in my book. I always want to explore, okay, what is not being said by everybody else? Then that will be my job, I will say that, you know. I can't see a taboo without wanting to smash it. You know, I want to write about the things that everybody else says should remain silent. And when I got to the States, I was excited for the first time I would have freedom of speech, you know. So I would come back from dinner parties crippled from being kicked under the table by my husband, you know, my shins, black and blue. He says, you know, just because you've got freedom of speech, it doesn't mean you should use it all the time. And he said, you're like the nouveau riche of freedom of speech. Those of us who've had it for a few generations, we're more tasteful on it. And, you know, that was another lesson that really this incredible gift that people had to use their speech, they weren't doing it. Instead, there was either the self-censorship, you know, just a kind of silence and a way in which you, as long as the individual, the self, is taken care of, you don't have to speak out for the injustice of everyone around you. In fact, that's dangerous and it shouldn't be done because, you know, it'll rock the boat. And for me, that was shocking because I thought, if you have freedom of speech, you have a moral obligation to use it and use it responsibly. So anyway, I used it irresponsibly for a long time, mostly because I was so excited to have it. And I became a US citizen because I was so outspoken about what I saw in my adopted culture that I thought they're going to throw me out the country unless I, you know, own a US passport. And so that was lucky for my mother because when I finally, I'd always written books because, you know, I couldn't count. So I'd written 9 novels. They all were rejected. They were terrible novels. And finally, my agent fired me. And she said, you can't write. You don't. She said, maybe you can write a little bit, but you don't have a story. And my then husband, so now I'm really rejected. I was so depressed. So he went to climb active volcanoes in Mexico because that was better than being with, you know, suicidally rejected writer. But when he left to go to Mexico, he left an envelope on, we shared an office in those days, and the envelope said only to be opened in the event of my death. So I waited till he got to the bottom of the driveway and I opened this envelope and it was very boring about the mortgage and insurance and all those things. But at the end, he said, I think you should just write the truth. And so that first book, which in French is L'Homme de Pierre, I wrote it in 6 weeks, just while he was gone to Mexico. It was, I do have a story, you know. And my mother, to begin, was very excited to hear I'd published a book that she waited her whole life. She tried to have someone write about it. And she read the book. She was not excited. And she said, this awful book. And she, the way she explained to all her friends, well, yes, Bobo has written a book, but it's an American book. And she said, what Americans like to do is write books about how they weren't kissed enough as children. And then they like to go on the Oprah show and cry about it. So it was really accidental that I ended up, you know, writing a memoir. It was only because my novels were so bad. And I wrote this memoir because I thought nobody would read it. It would never be published. And what I was, you know, accused of or praised for was how honest this thing was, you see. And it made me realize, then everybody else is just lying all the time. You know, if I'm so brutally honest, then maybe that's the thing. Everybody has just sort of been lying. And so by accident, I ended up writing these, you know, brutally honest. I keep getting that review every book. Another searingly honest, brutally honest book. But what's as important for me as the honesty is also compassion. Because if you write without compassion, then it can just feel very cruel. For me, the most important thing is that in every book there's this. They're all love stories in a way, you know. They're a love story to my mother and a love story to the land that raised me. And ultimately, this last book, people say, oh, it's a divorce book or a broken love story between me and my husband, because in this book there's a divorce. It's none of that. It's a love story to myself. It's like Spinoza said, you can love something with all your heart, but it's not incumbent upon that thing to love you in return, all the way to God, you know. And so my earliest lesson was I could love land really passionately, but with no obligation on the land's part to love me back, or even, you know, I felt possessed by Zambia, but Zambia had no interest in possessing me. And to learn that story, you know, that truth very young, of course, you don't embody it then, because you still hope, oh, well, you know, love will somehow rescue me. I mean, all this nonsense you sort of believe to be true. And then to feel that, yes, you can have a love story that is another kind of dispossession, that that it can begin to feel like a sort of solitary confinement in the culture of a marriage, that you're no longer speaking your truth, that there is a kind of schizophrenia. You know, you're yourself outside of the context of the marriage, and within the marriage, you find yourself censoring yourself. And for me, that there was nothing more terrifying than having fought so hard to have a voice, I lose it anywhere. And so it was necessary for me to end the marriage. And you know, Americans are so ridiculously romantic. Everything has to be the end of Hollywood, has to, you know. So when they read the book and they hear this terrible accident, they say, but you should have stayed with him. And I say, what other instruction from God did I need? You know, a horse fell on the man. This was the end. It was clear that in this way in which we had begun to silence each other, there was a very quiet violence at work. You know, like Jung says, if you don't express the unconscious will feel free to express itself on you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And really, you know, it was important for me, because I have three children, that I remain very sacred in speaking of their father, because, you know, he's their father. And so that really helped me in the writing of the book, that there were some things, you know, there's a privilege of intimacy, you know, 20 years of marriage, that was a privilege that I not violate, and that there's a big difference between what is private and what is personal. And what is private should remain private. And what is personal, I mean, after all, that's universal. So that's fine to write about. But for me, that was always the distinction. My father accidentally raised me to be a son. And partly that was circumstances, you know, where we were growing up. So it was very clear when I was growing up that, I mean, the instructions were, go out, you've got the whole of Africa to play, and just don't shoot your sister above the knees, and otherwise you'll be fine. And, you know, he taught me to ride a horse, which I've done with Nina, and shoot a gun, and, you know, fix a Land Rover if it breaks down. But these are not helpful qualities in a marriage. It was as if they had raised me in an impossible wild that I couldn't belong to. And then they panicked when, you know, when I came of age. What do we do with this wild child that we've raised? We've given her these impossible, gifts that are useless everywhere, but she should just marry someone. So, because they're English, they thought perhaps I should marry some rich Englishman. Even my father took my side then. He says, no, that's ridiculous. The last good Englishman died out with Churchill and the other chap. I said, what other chap? He said, I don't know, but there must have been at least one other. So that was the other sort of shocking thing, was there was a big disconnect between the way I was raised to be so independent and so capable, and yet with no real skills. And those skills are useful in Zambia, but no skills for the developed world, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think what my husband saw in me was, oh, she's wild, but she's, you know, she looks somewhat as if she might fit in. I didn't realize that he was from this very posh American family. When the Americans would come to, mostly to see, woo my sister, you know, the American Peace Corps workers, the mission, you know, these people who go out to dig a latrine in the bush for whatever, and they'd come and find my sister. My mother would say, what family do you come from? And they would assure her, very old American family. She said, you can't be that bloody old. You're not Red Indian, are you? So she, you know, her snobbery was always that if you marry someone from America, they're new family. They're not, you know. So I don't really know. I thought she would be okay with Charlie because he could ride a horse and he had a dog. And she would approve of that. But when he told me he was from, Nina will know what this means. I had no clue. The main line Philadelphia, they call themselves, and it's the train line or something in Philadelphia where the old families in America live, and their old money and their old names, and they marry each other, so they end up with no chins. So it's the sorts of chinless wonders of the, and when he told me he was from mainline Philadelphia, I thought, oh, thank God, they're heroin addicts. This'll be perfect. They'll fit in with my family. So I was confused.